We are live. Please start.
Good evening, friends. Welcome to the PG Track program of Delhi CSI into the 60th webinar. And today we are going to have the second case discussion series. The earlier one was a great success. We had great discussions on rheumatic heart disease, case-based approach. And today we are having a discussion on cyanotic congenital heart disease. An approach. And we have the privilege and pleasure of having Professor N. Sodhay Kumar, who's professor and head of the cardiology in the Travancore Medical College. Sir has given already three terrific lectures. It's been great listening to him. And then we have our colleague, Dr. Ranjit Nath, who's professor and head of the cardiology at RML Hospital, and Atal Bihari Vajpayee Institute of Medical Sciences, a great teacher and a great cardiologist. We also have the pleasure of having our colleagues, Dr. Sumodh Kurian, Professor of Cardiology at GB Pant, Professor Girish MP, and Dr. Nitish Naik would be joining soon, and myself, Dr. Mohit Gupta. We have the residents who have joined. Today, Dr. Dhanji Chaudhary, the final year resident from GB Pant Hospital, would be presenting the case, which will be discussed by Dr. Sodhay Kumar and Dr. Ranjit Nath, and Dr. Sumodh would be the moderator. And we also have other residents, Dr. Pandey, Dr. Shaukat, Dr. Sudhir, and would be happy to have a discussion and questions from them also. So without wasting any time, I would invite Dr. Dhanji Chaudhary to please start the presenting the case and share his screen immediately. In case you have any questions, comments, and clarifications, and anything, you please write to us on the chat box. We'll be happy to answer and take up all your questions in the end.
Is my screen visible, sir?
Yes.
Perfect. Good. Go ahead.
Good evening, respected teachers. Before starting the case discussion, I would like to thank the whole team of PG Track program for giving me opportunity to present myself a case in front of eminent teachers like Dr. Ranjit Nath sir and Dr. Sudhay Kumar sir. Today, I would like to discuss a case of a 12-year male Muslim coming from the Uttar Pradesh, who is studying in the 6th standard and coming from the lower socioeconomic class. Chief complaints of this patient, the bluish discoloration of the lips and skin since 4 months of age, breathlessness on exertion since 3 years of age, history of the presenting illness. History was given by mother and the father of the patient. As per mother, her child was born out of normal vaginal delivery and was apparently normal at birth. She noticed that her child has bluish discoloration of lips, skin, toes, fingers at the age of 4 months. She also observed that child was episodically becoming more blue while waking up from the sleep, feeding or crying, which was associated with tachypnea, but without loss of consciousness or seizures. But after the episode, child was becoming more sleepy or sloppy. These episodes decreased after the age of 2 to 3 years. Patient also has another complaint of breathlessness on exertion since 3 years of age. Initially, breathlessness was on running, playing with the same age group children, which has progressed over the period of time that now he becomes breathless even while walking approximately 200 to 300 meters. Patient assumes squatting position during such episodes for 5 to 10 minutes, which relieves him from the breathlessness, and then he starts to walk again. There is no history of recurrent chest infection, no history of failure to thrive or delayed milestones, no history of loss of consciousness or tonic-clonic movements. There is no history of long-standing or recurrent fever or skin lesions, no history of joint pain or swelling, no history of limb weakness, headache, giddiness, tinnitus, dimness of vision. There is no history of feet of edema, abdominal distension, or loss of appetite, no history of hemoptysis or palpitation. In birth history, patient was born out of non-consanguineous marriage at the full-term vaginal delivery. Birth weight was normal. There is no vaccination history or documents available. Developmental history, it is normal. There is no delayed developmental milestones. In maternal history, there is no history of diabetes, hypertension or major medical illness in mother. No history of fever with skin rashes or other infection during the pregnancy. No history of smoking, alcohol or drug abuse or thyroid disorders during the pregnancy. Past history, patient was referred to our hospital from a peripheral hospital for further evaluation and was on some medication without any history of intervention. Family and personal history. Patient is the fifth child with three elder brothers and one younger sister. There is no any significant relevant history in the other siblings. Patient is non-vegetarian by diet with normal appetite, gallbladder and sleep is normal, and there is no habits. To summarize, we are having a 12-year-old male who was normal at birth and up to 4 months of his age. Started to have a cyanosis and a cyanotic spell from 4 months of age, where cyanosis is persistent, but the spell episodes has decreased after the age of 3 years. There is progressive breathlessness on exertion, which started with increased activity, which is relieved by respiratory episodes without history of congestive cardiac failure, failure to thrive, infective endocarditis, or complication of cyanosis.
We can't see the candidate.
Ranji, please switch on your video.
Yes. Yeah. So, if I ask you, Ranji, you said breathlessness. What do you mean by breathlessness? Progressive breathlessness.
So, initially, at the age of 3 years, when the child started to walk and run, he was having the fatigue and he was not able to match up with his age groups. And afterwards, he gets breathlessness and he tried to avoid the breathlessness by giving a squatting position.
I got your point, but I am asking you, what do you mean? What do you mean by breathlessness? What is the physiology equivalent of breathlessness?
Squatting position, sir. Which is...
So you want to say there is breathlessness because of increased pulmonary venous hypertension, or what do you mean by breathlessness? Or you want to say breathlessness because of reduced oxyhemoglobin? What is the meaning of breathlessness? You want to say?
Sir, it is. I want to infer from this the reduced oxyhemoglobin, hypoxemia.
So you are saying that these are hypercyanotic spells.
So initially, from 4 months to 3 years of age, he was having the hypercyanotic spell, but now he is having the breathlessness on exertion with squatting episode.
Dr. Injit is asking, what is the mechanism, mechanism of breathlessness in a patient with cyanosis? What is the mechanism?
On exertion, one is the increasing the requirement of the oxygenation for the body. And because on exertion, there is a decrease in the systemic vascular resistance, which may increase the right to left shunting, which leads to systemic hypoxemia.
So that will lead to breathlessness, you want to say?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Second point I want to ask you is, are you sure that the child is having reduced blood flow from your history?
Yes, sir.
That is because of your cyanotic spells, you want to say?
And there is no history of sir congestive cardiac failure like recurrent low respiratory tract infection or failure to thrive or that thing. So...
When you're saying it's always the positive history, don't go to the negative one. What is the positive history?
Yes, sir. Other than the cyanotic spell and cyanosis, that the patient is not having the history of congestive cardiac failure. So I want to infer from that the patient is having the cyanosis with reduced pulmonary blood flow.
Quickly recapitulate, what are the questions you asked to rule out congestive heart failure in at 4 to 5 months of age? What are the signs of and symptoms of congestive heart failure at 4 to 5 months of age?
Sir, during the feeding, the child is having the perspiration, tachypnea, grunting, and suck rest, suck cycle, and then child becomes lethargic.
Lethargic?
Yes.
Okay, so you took all those histories?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Dr. Surya Kumar, sir, you can ask.
Okay. Now, my approach is first exam-oriented. I will just put it like this. can you tell us what are the questions you are likely to be asked? Tell me at least 5 questions that will be asked by the examiner.
So one that what is the possible physiology in this patient?
Okay.
And if you are going with one physiology, then how you will differentiate from others?
Okay. And what is the physiology in this case? Okay.
In this case,
then you answer. Okay. Then second.
Other things are what is the severity of the disease?
Severity of the disease. Okay. Mm-hmm. So we should know which are the questions that are likely to be asked. So whenever I take a class, I ask them note down the questions that are being asked, because in the examination usually monotonous questions. You can get the answer from the books or from your colleagues. So you should know which are the questions that are asked. The common question one is, what is the physiology? Okay, that is question which has been already asked. Then, what are the question that is asked? What is the mechanism of squatting? What is the mechanism of spells? How will you treat the spells? Okay. Is this a low flow group or a high flow group? Okay. Whatever you have said, there will be questions on that. Okay. So we'll, before going back, can you go to the previous slide? Just the previous slide. And okay, let us put it no, one way. Okay, let us be like this. Okay, fine. Next. The next slide. Okay, what is the relevance of asking all these questions? Second, a little comment about the history. There is no past history in this case.
Past history,
nothing, because he has started from the third month. So where is the past history? So whatever is included. So in a pediatric cardiology, where you start from the day one or in the early infancy, there is no past history. You can include at the end of the relevant things. You can put it as the additional comorbid conditions or whatever it is, because there is nothing past, because you have put the whole thing. Second was a question which was asked, what is the mechanism of breathlessness in this case, the physiological mechanism, you have put it. One is desaturation. There is defective oxygen supply to the brain as well as to the exercising muscles, so that the muscles become fatigued. When there is reduced oxygen supply to the brainstem, there will be hyperventilation, stimulation of the respiratory center. There will be reduced oxygen delivery to the respiratory muscles. The respiratory muscles become easily fatigued. Okay. These are the, that's what the answer what sir wanted was, it is a reduced oxygen delivery. Whereas the other two conditions will be, one is, as sir said, pulmonary venous hypertension seen in left heart disease. Or when there is an inadequate cardiac output, when the cardiac output doesn't rise adequately, or when it falls, there is inadequate again oxygen delivery to the respiratory muscles or whatever muscles. So these are the three physiological mechanisms of breathlessness. Now, related to that, I will ask a question. Why you said the low flow group? Low flow group, the answer was, you tell me the positive things. One, you have to say cyanotic pulse. Second, squatting. These are the two positive things you have to say. Then the negative is absence of heart failure, recurrent respiratory infection. Okay, so squatting and cyanotic pulse, we have to tell. Why the breathlessness? The next question was, why the breathlessness increase with exercise? One, as you have rightly pointed out, there is an increased need for oxygen demand, which cannot be met. Second, as you have rightly put it, there is vasodilatation. Probably you should not say. When there is vasodilatation, definitely there is a reduction in the pulmonary blood flow. You should talk about pulmonary blood flow rather than the right to left shunt. Because basically it is the pulmonary blood flow which determines the oxygen. There is a crux in this thing. So you can tell either way. So when there is a systemic vasodilatation, the systemic vascular resistance falls, the pulmonary blood flow reduces, right to left shunt increases. What happened to the contractility of the outflow tract? Because there is catecholamine release, the contractility, don't use the term spasm. Because spasm is a term used for smooth muscles. So better, at least some of the geriatric examiners like us would like to have hypercontractility. There is the RVOT tract, contract, just like hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, the RV outflow tract may be more responsible, more irritable. So when exercise, when the patient exercises, the catecholamines are released, the contractility increases, the RVOT obstruction increases. But the additional point not in favor of that is, even in pulmonary atresia, you get these things. Now, taking this history of present illness, whenever you are putting a point, I may ask, what is the relevance of history of recurrent chest infections?
Sir, I didn't get the question. What is the
relevance of history of present presenting illness or you have put it like this, no history of recurrent respiratory infections. What is the relevance of that?
Sir, it suggests that the pulmonary blood flow has not increased, and because the recurrent respiratory infection occurs in the patient who is having the increased interstitial edema. It can
only one of the reasons we know. But we know that tetralogy of Fallot can have other problems. Their immunological mechanism is defective. They are prone for infection even otherwise. Then tetralogy of Fallot with absent pulmonary valve, you can have obstruction of the airways due to the dilated pulmonary artery. So a recurrent chest infection is relevant when it is associated with heart failure. Even otherwise, they can have a recurrent respiratory infections. No history of failure to thrive, okay, delayed milestone. No history of loss of consciousness or tonic or clonic movements. What is the relevance of that?
So during the cyanotic spell, patient can lose the consciousness and have
I am including the whole illness because there is nothing past in this
patient. Patient with cyanotic heart disease are having increased risk of developing cerebral abscess or cortical venous sir, because of sir, one it is the right to left shunt which causes
you
the
straight away paradoxical embolism. Then they will ask you what are the neurological manifestations of cyanotic congenital heart disease. So you have to ask so many things. One is that. Second is,
sir, one is sir, patient is because of repeated hypoxemia, hypoxic spell, it leads to neurocognitive dysfunction. And
we are talking about loss of consciousness, tonic clonic movements. So
sir,
this a brain dysfunction of transient nature or a reversible nature. So you have to think of seizure activity, headache, loss of consciousness, hyperviscosity syndrome, sagittal vein, venous thrombosis, infarct they can have. So all those things you should know whenever you are asking these questions. Then no history of long-standing recurrent fever or skin lesion. What is the relevance of that? No history of skin lesions. It looked a little odd for me. What was in your mind? This is the way I conduct the examination or I teach. Each time you should know why we are asking. Skin lesion, what is the relevance?
Because of the infective endocarditis having the skin manifestation.
Okay. But then you will end up in trouble. How often you have seen skin manifestation in endocarditis? You will be taken for a ride on endocarditis because seldom you get skin lesion. So you have said no history of long-standing recurrent, long-standing or recurrent fever or other features to suggest endocarditis. Okay. Otherwise, it looks a little odd, that terminology. Okay. That you will be inviting questions. No history of joint pain or swelling?
Sir, because the age group is prone for rheumatic fever, so I also included it. Other than cyanotic.
No. That should not be the answer in this case. Because you are dealing with cyanotic congenital heart disease.
Sir.
Symptoms starting at the age of 3 months. So there is no question of discussing rheumatic fever. But what is the importance?
Well, sir, in patient with the, because of the increased erythrocytosis and increased turnover leads to hyperuricemia and gout.
You know the answer. So that is a priority you have to give. So I will be looking for secondary gout. That is you straight away say secondary gout, then the examiner knows this guy knows everything. No history of limb weakness, that we have discussed, that is neurological complicant or thing. No history of hemoptysis. What is the mechanism of hemoptysis? Why do you talk about hemoptysis? What do you talk? Why do you want to talk about palpitations?
In patient with the cyanotic heart disease, because of the collaterals like bronchial collaterals, which can rupture and can lead to hemoptysis, which is more.
One is rupture of the bronchopulmonary collaterals. Okay, fine.
Other it is sir pulmonary infarctions.
Yes, why due to pulmonary infarction due to?
It can be because of two things. One is the thrombosis that is causing, and other thing it can be because of infective endocarditis.
Okay, in situ thrombosis. You have to say in situ thrombosis, the abnormal pulmonary vasculature, the coagulation parameters are abnormal in cyanotic congenital heart disease. Then you can talk about right sided. You have to specifically say right sided endocarditis. There again, you should be careful because this is likely to apply to a systemic as well as to the pulmonary side. Okay. Now, what about the palpitation?
Sir, certain cyanotic congenital heart disease are having the palpitation. Epstein anomaly, CTGA.
CTGA, what is the commonest arrhythmia in CTGA? complete heart block. AV conduction problems are more common. It can happen. Then third, AV canal defect,
single atrium.
So these are the conditions. Now, if you take single atrium also, any situation where there is a large atria, high atrial pressures, classically it is a palpitation more in Epstein's. Why?
Because sort of the accessory pathways.
Because of the huge right atrium, there are ectopic activity as well as atrial arrhythmias, plus the contribution by accessory pathway. So that's why I said that always the students gives us the question. You should be able to, when you are presenting each statement, you should be careful. Each statement, you should be careful because you are giving us questions. I think we'll just go through that. That's a point which I want to highlight. And coming to the discussion, you have clearly said it is the usual monotonous discussion. Is it a high flow group or a low flow group? That is a very simple question. Yes, Dr. Nath?
Yeah, one point to add is that in cause of hemoptysis, one more point comes is sometimes tuberculosis is more in this age group also. So that also can be added into the list you have added. Okay, so let us go to the diseases that you are thinking of after going through this history. What are the diseases that you are thinking of?
Cyanotic heart disease with the reduced pulmonary blood flow. First of all, I would Fallot's physiology. And in the Fallot's physiology, I would like to go with the tetralogy of Fallot condition. While other physiology, it can be, but it is very less likely, like trilogy physiology.
What physiology?
It's a trilogy.
Trilogy physiology, usually not a usually discussed terminology. What are the abnormal physiologies in cyanotic heart disease? Basically, the physiologies could be cyanosis could be due to tetralogy of Fallot physiology. Then,
sir, one is the Fallot's physiology. Another it is Eisenmenger physiology.
Yeah, that's
another. Another one is transposition physiology. Another one is in PS with interventricular septal with right to left center. Detail level.
Okay, the three or four is something we also discuss about the admixture physiology also. Admixture physiology also we discuss. So basically, tetralogy of Fallot physiology, where it is systemic right ventricle with RVOT obstruction. Second, and a non-restrictive VSD. Second is the transposition physiology. You know which are the conditions included in that. Then admixture physiology and Eisenmenger physiology. Okay, good. Dr. Nath?
Yeah, if I ask you to divide this physiology on the basis of pulmonary flow and PAH, how you classify?
Yes, sir. Patient, the normal PAH are like Fallot physiology and.
I'm saying how you classify. One is you said is a reduced blood flow with VSD that is Fallot's physiology.
Yes,
then you say trilogy also, that is septum PS with atrial subduction. Then you say it is increased pulmonary blood flow physiology, that's RS already mentioned. Any other physiology you know?
Yes, sir, with the PS due to pulmonary venous hypertension, that because of hypoplastic left heart or obstructive DAPVC, obstructive.
Do you know any disease that is normal pulmonary blood flow, normal PA pressure physiology?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. That is LSVC to LA and pulmonary arterial fistula can have most of the normal.
So, what are the diseases? You said one is Fallot's physiology. You are any other disease you are thinking of in this patient?
Only, sir, Fallot's physiology group I can think of, like tetralogy of Fallot or DORV VSTPS or then TGA VSTPS. But in the Fallot's physiology group only, yes.
Only you are thinking, not an Eisenmenger physiology, you are not thinking of at all.
No, sir.
Only because of your, why you are not thinking of Eisenmenger physiology at all?
Sir, patient with Eisenmenger physiology usually having the three kind of clinical presentation. That is, one it is mostly, and usually it is because of the initial in the childhood or infancy, there is a increased left to right shunt, like ASD, VSD, PSD, which will give the symptoms of congestive heart failure. And later on, they will become the clinically stable. And afterwards, they will present in the adult age, like in the second, third, or fourth decade with the dyspnea on exertion or cyanosis and clubbing. And another presentation is the complex synovial congenital heart disease with increased pulmonary blood flow, like transfusion physiology, which converted into the isolated physiology. But this patient also will be having the congestive cardiac failure symptom initially. And one rare, but third presentation of Eisenmenger, it is like NCDS presentation where there is no history of congestive cardiac failure. And patient is, because the PVR has not fallen after the birth and it is persistently high. And so it presents directly the cyanosis club in this non-existent.
And the question is, why in this particular place?
You because
you answer this, be specific. Be very specific in your answers, okay?
Another point to discuss is that, Dhanji, you are relying on history only till now. You are not examined. No, whatever history is given by parents, you cannot corroborate 100% now. So if you say that those spell-like situations are definitely hypersynaptic spells, you are not sure. So only that is the history that you are excluding a cyanosis at 12 years of birth, is not it?
Yes.
Rest of the things you cannot exclude. So what are the other bases that you are excluding Eisenmenger physiology?
Other than Eisenmenger physiology, transposition physiology I am excluding. And with the pH, with the raised, that is because of PVH, I am excluding. And I am excluding trilogy physiology as well.
Okay. Sir, go ahead, Surya, sir.
Regarding the way I will be answering the questions or the things which we have to discuss, one, you have to tell very clearly that this child has cyanotic spells and history of squatting, which indicate that the pulmonary blood flow is inadequate. It is a reduced pulmonary blood flow with RVOT, whatever it is, there is pulmonary obstruction to pulmonary blood flow. So we are going in for a low flow group. That is the first thing. Then when you are discussing, there will be a hybrid. For example, in transposition of great arteries, it's a hybrid situation which present. They have transposition physiology plus tetralogy of fellow. So there are limitations in these strict classifications. We are conveying. So when you get transposition with the pulmonary stenosis, there are two physiologies in that. One is the transposition physiology, which is producing the mixing, and they present with cyanosis quite early. Okay. Then the second thing is they have a TOF physiology also. The VSD may be large and there is an obstruction to flow of blood to the pulmonary circuit. So that is there. Similarly, you take tricuspiratory or single ventricle. In tricuspiratory and single ventricle also, you find that there is an admixture physiology. Admixture physiology. And majority of the cases, they will have pulmonary stenosis also. So resulting in reduced pulmonary blood flow. That is the limitation of this type of simple classification which we monotonously ask. But you have to go like that. There is some examiners will tell. But the moment you find that this patient has cyanosis which appeared later, the limitation for that, why not transposition? The transposition, the cyanosis appears quite early. But parents detect cyanosis. So before that, when you are presenting, the child was born in hospital. He was examined by the neonatologist or the cardiologist. Then it was not detected to have cyanosis in the early neonatal period. That you have to tell. Because we also failed to pick up cyanosis. For cyanosis, what is oxygen saturation needed to clinically detect cyanosis by us? What is the amount of oxygen saturation needed? Systemic oxygen saturation has to be?
Less than 85%.
Less than 85. So for a layman, so he detected or the parents noticed cyanosis at 3 months. Doesn't mean that the cyanosis appeared at 3 months. That limitation you have to talk, because when you are discussing other conditions which can present with cyanosis earlier. Because if we have examined the patient, no cyanosis, and 3rd month the child is developing cyanosis, most likely it will be tetralogy of Fallot. Whereas if the child develops cyanosis in the 1st week or 2nd week, and the rest of the things are same, it may not be straightforward tetralogy of Fallot. It may be a straight tetralogy of Fallot like physiology, as you have said, DORV, corrected transposition of great arteries, or a pulmonary stenosis situation along with a mixing situation or a transposition mixing. So that is very important. Whether the child was evaluated, seen earlier. So don't say that the cyanosis started. It was only detected. Detection doesn't mean that the child did not have cyanosis early. That is the number one point. Then when you are discussing this thing, you have to say, sir, it's a tetralogy of Fallot-like physiology or low flow. The first is tetralogy of Fallot physiology, which includes there is a difference of opinion among the pediatric cardiologists, geriatric cardiologists, and even among us, which are the conditions we include. Classical tetralogy of Fallot you can include, DOR with PS you can include, corrective transfusion of great arteries with PS you can include. Okay, but when it comes to TGA with PS or single ventricle with PS or tricuspid atresia with PS, many of us may not agree with that straight away, but you have to discuss that. That is, there are two physiologies in that. The next question was, the question that will be asked will be, what is the mechanism of the spell? Monotonous question, you know the answer, but I would like to add something and how it is relieved. Mechanism of cyanotic spell. You know the answers. That is, sudden increase in the activity, increase in the catecholamine release, increased physical activity, systemic vasodilatation because of the lactic acidosis which can happen, the systemic vascularescence falls, right to left shunt increases, that cycle goes on. Then catecholamines increases the RVOT obstruction. Then they can have some tachyarrhythmias. But you should talk about the respiratory center also. The resetting of the respiratory center is hyper-responsive because during sleep, there was no stimulus for the respiratory center. Because the oxygen saturation was less, so the respiratory center was a little depressed or which was kept under rest. Because during sleep, the child has a better oxygenation. So the respiratory center had a respiratory, the oxygen saturation was low. So the respiratory drive was less. Suddenly, this is reset by the activity and the hyperventilation, all those things. Then mechanism by which spells are relieved. What are the mechanism by which spells are relieved? Yeah, that you should know. How the spells are relieved?
Why you give a squatting position? So go ahead.
Yes, sir. By acquiring the
child assumes the squatting position. Knee chest position. So what is, what happens?
Squatting position or squatting equivalent position, there is a increase in a systemic vascular resistance.
Just to wait there. There is a cardiac physiologist may not be very happy because what is why the this is going up, whatever you said is going up, SVR is going up
because cerebral kink the arteries and
the difference between a mechanical obstruction to the artery like coartation versus systemic vascular resistance? Systemic vascular resistance is the resistance offered by the smaller arterioles. So here is a mechanical obstruction occurring to the aorta. So it is better you say central aortic pressure rises. You may get away with this systemic vascular resistance because almost all of us are tuned to that. The central aortic pressure rises so that the right to left shunt decreases, number one.
Other thing is, sir, because it will
why decrease. Why the central aortic pressure rises? Two things. One is the kinging, something like a obstruction to the femoral arteries. Am I right? What is the other thing raises the central aortic pressure? The intra-abdominal pressure rises on squatting. So that will be transmitted to the aorta. So the central aortic pressure rises. Third?
Another thing is decreases the deoxygenated blood returns to the heart.
How? Kinging the femoral veins. Am I right?
Yes.
And sudden decrease in the exercise, pooling of blood in the. But what is the method by which the net oxygen saturation increases to the right, in the net oxygen saturation, the right atrium, right ventricle increases? One is reduction in the desaturated venous return from the exercising muscles. Next is?
Another, sir, it will increase the pulmonary blood flow.
No. That is why my question, did you listen to the question? Why the net oxygen saturation of the venous blood, mixed venous blood, coming to the right ventricle and to the pulmonary?
Other thing is because the lower limb muscles will be, blood supply will be reduced.
No, that we have said that the venous return, deoxygenated venous return comes down. Because of the kinging, all those intra-abdominal pressure rises, which increases the splanchnic venous return. The splanchnic vein has a higher oxygen saturation. The splanchnic, adrenal, everything. The blood flow is not for oxygen delivery, it is for other purpose. The splanchnic vein has a greater oxygen saturation. So what happens is, it will be squeezed by the increased intra-abdominal pressure. So that the higher saturated blood volume increases, and the desaturated volume will decrease. Then when the blood pressure, when the aortic pressure rises, what happened to the sympathetic activity?
reflexly it should decrease. It comes will reflexly down. Yes, sir. So
what
it
happens?
Will
decrease. The heart rate comes down. The heart rate comes down. The contractility comes down. RVOT also comes. The obstruction also releases. So these are the mechanisms by which the pulmonary blood flow increases on squatting position. Yes, Dr. Nath.
Yeah.
Doctor.
Okay, so the you have minimized your DD to cyanotic congenital heart disease tetralogy of fellow's physiology, is not it?
Yes, sir. Fellow's physiology.
So can we go to the examinations now? Then just
I would like to have a differential diagnosis. So what are the possibilities you will consider?
What are the possibilities out of the top physiology you consider?
Which are the conditions you will consider by statistics? No. Then you go by statistics only.
By sir, age of the patient is 12 years. So survival in at the 12 year of age, I will first consider TOF
that,
and classical TOF. Other thing I will consider for the DORV VSD PS.
Yes.
And afterwards I will consider for TGA VSD PS.
TGA VSD PS, usually the cyanosis we should detect quite early. 3 months it is very, very unlikely. But so because already there is mixing. So already there is a transposition and there is a pulmonary blood flow is less. So we expect cyanosis. So conditions which produce, I mean, we have to take the history with all the limitations. Cyanosis appearing by 3 months, we put low in the list, transposition of great arteries low in the list. Single ventricle is one thing which can present at any time. That is one thing which you should never forget. Epstein's anomaly can present at any time, but cyanotic spell is very uncommon with that. Because there is cyanotic pulse, I fully agree with you. But in the examination, you have, and finally, if you are asked what will you put as the first two possibilities, you should say, sir, I will put straight away classical tetralogy of my strong possibility, followed by most likely DOR with PS. Okay.
So do you think, just one question, as sir has asked you, so I just want to, do you think that TGA and tricuspid atresia can be acyanotic for some time, then develop cyanosis?
Yes, sir. Transposition with the good mixing can present with the mild cyanosis or late cyanosis.
Okay, and tricuspid atresia?
Tricuspid atresia with the large VSD can present later.
Tricuspid atresia with large VSD.
It's a good
now,
pulmonary.
Is it a low flow group or a high flow group?
It will go into the high flow group, sir. That but if there is a pulmonary.
Because in tetralogy, tricuspid atresia, the pulmonary blood flow is determined mainly by the size of the VSD. There are restrictions at the VSD site. So very unlikely there will be a large VSD plus PS, but there is no need for a large VSD in that case. Okay.
Okay, go ahead to your examination.
I think Dr. Sumodh, Dr. Gupta.
Sir, actually, the only thing is that many times we follow the Dr. Tandon's classification. So when he says transposition physiology, it is equivalent to admixture physiology because we assume that he's saying this because Dr. Tandon in his book, he classifies admixture physiology as a transposition physiology. So they are equivalent terminologies that we use.
Oh, fine. No
but
problem.
From that,
no problem.
Now, the problem, the point is examiners are flexible now. You have to convey your knowledge. That is all what is needed. Some oddities we will accept. I will accept straight away. Okay. Fine. Go ahead.
Sir, in general examination, patient was conscious, oriented, and cooperative. Anthropometry data were normal. Built nutrition and the facial dysmorphism was normal. There was central cyanosis, which was uniform. There was a clubbing, which was grade 3, and it was uniform in all the four limbs. Saturation at rest was 75% to 80% in all four limbs. There was no pallor, icterus, edema, or lymphadenopathy. Back and spine were normal, and temperature was normal. Pulse that was 92 per minute, which was regular in rhythm, normal volume. There was no radioradial or radiofemoral delay. Condition of the underlying artery was normal with the normal peripheral pulsation. Blood pressure was 102 by 70 mmHg in the upper limbs and 110 by 72 in the lower limbs. Jugular venous pulse that was normal and pulsatile with normal A and B waves. X and Y descent at 30 degree. Abdominal jugular reflux was flat and was negative. Respiration, that was 18 per minute, which was regular, and abdominal thoracic type. There was no peripheral sign of infective endocarditis or aortic regurgitation. Inspection, chest was normal in shape, pecordium was normal. Apical impulse was seen at the inframammary region, just medial to the left midclavicular line. No suprasternal, epigastric, or other impulses were seen. There was no scar, sinuses, or dilated veins. Palpation, inspection, findings were confirmed with the palpation. Apex mid was palpable in the fifth intercostal space at 1 centimeter medial to the left midclavicular line, occupying more than one intercostal space with lateral retraction. Grade 1 parastornal yield was present in the left fourth and fifth intercostal space. There was no epigastric or liver or other pulsation. There was no palpable sound or thrill. On percussion, tympanic knot was heard in the left hypochondrium and dull knot was observed in the right hypochondrium. Left heart border corresponded to the apex. Right heart border was at the right sternal border. Upper border of the liver dullness was in the right fifth intercostal space in the clavicular line. Left second intercostal space was resonant. In auscultation, S1 was normal, S2 was single without respiratory variation. There was no S3, no S4, or no other sounds heard. There was an ejection systolic murmur of grade 2/6, and it was brief in duration. It was best heard in the second and third intercostal space at left parasternal region, not radiating to other areas. Best heard with the diaphragm of the stethoscope in sitting position and leaning forward at the held expiration, which increases on isometric and grip exercise. Other system examination was normal.
Can you go back to palpation?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Why you said it's a parasternal heave? What was the criteria that you said this is parasternal heave grade 1?
Sir, reading of parasternal heave, that is when it is in the parasternal region, fourth and fifth intercostal space, it was faintly felt. It was not lifting the heel of the hand. So,
how you differentiate between a heave and a parasternal pulsation?
So parasternal heave will increase the, that it will lift the hand above the chest.
Above the chest?
Means it will lift the hand.
But you said it is just palpated, disappeared on pressure. So above the chest, how will it happen?
So in grade 1, it is faintly palpable. In grade 2, it is prominently palpable, but it is obliterable by the pressure, and in grade 3 it was not obliterable.
So we clinically say that if the lift is more than 50% of systole, then it is heave, and if it is less than brief or less than 50% of systole, then we call it parastornal pulsation. So if we feel in the early part of systole, we call it pulsation. If it sustains for more than 50%, then we call it a heave. So if you are dealing with a tetralogy physiology, then why you are getting a heave? Why the pressure overload is there? How do you explain?
Sir, actually it should be parasternal lift, because you cannot explain because there is a decompression of the right ventricle, so it cannot reach more suprasystemic pressure, even though there is a right ventricular hypertrophy is there.
Is it possible to have a heave in a case of a tetralogy-like situation with other your auscultatory finding? Is it possible to have?
In sir, patient with the Hoffman variant, where there is a restrictive BST is there.
But
there
with your other findings, is it possible? Because you have a very brief murmur. So is it possible?
No, sir. With that, it is not possible.
Okay. So you said the last statement, no palpable sound or thrill. And in your second statement, you said apex beat is palpable. What is apex beat?
Sir, apex beat is the apical impulse that gives a perpendicular thrust to the palpating finger. that is usually most outermost and lowermost part in the pericardium.
So, is it the heart touches your heart?
Yes, sir. It is initial part of the systole where the heart touches anteriorly. Movement of the LV gives the apex beat.
Okay. So, do you know that some examiner believes that it is the first ultrasound that is palpable? First ultrasound tapping apex beat. Sometimes they say the loud first ultrasound that itself becomes palpable as well. So this statement doesn't go hand in hand. So no palpable sound or thrill. You could not feel a second heart sound?
No, sir.
Not at all. In upper part, there is no no finding. What are the things that you looked for to differentiate top physiology in palpation?
I will look for the second layer. That is, one is the type of apex, whether it is the RV type of apex or whether it is the LV type of apex. Another thing I will look for, it is the second left intercostal space, if it is palpable or not. That if it is palpable, then there is a possibility that it can trophy the absent pulmonary wall or a CTG kind of situation where it can be palpable in that area. So, in palpation.
Yeah, if suppose CTG, then you will get what? Palpable?
Palpable second heart sound. That is.
Second heart sound.
Louder. In the second left intercostal space.
Any other you look for that will help you in if you said apex you look for. So if apex is suppose palpable and very loudly palpable apex, very prominently heaving apex, then what will be your suspicion?
Sir, one is the tricuspid atresia or
heaving apex.
Heaving apical peristernal.
Apex is heaving.
Okay, sir.
And one is apex is LV type apex. So I am asking you heaving apex.
Sir, one is DORB with restrictive VST can present like that.
With, or palpable LV type of apex?
Yes, sir. In that it can present as a LV type of apex in DORB with restrictive VST.
No, I am asking you heaving apex. You are correctly said it is a DORB with restrictive VST. I agree with you. But if I say it is an LV type of apex, then what are the diseases will come?
So one is a tricuspid atresia, which will give a LV type of apex.
Very good. Second?
Others are TOF, where classical TOF is.
You will get LV type of apex.
No. In TOF, I will get RV type. But if it is complicated with like aortic regurgitation, or because of the increased flow like MAPCAS or PDA, can have LV type.
Sometimes. Any other causes of LV type of apex in a classical tetralogy? You correctly said if there is associated AR. Any other cause of LV type of apex in a case of TOF?
Sir, in case of associated coarctation of aorta or bicuspid aortic valve with aortic stenosis, can have LV type.
If there is a coarctation of aorta and if there is PS, so do you think this child will last for 12 years?
Yes.
Or apex will be only palpable, it will not be heaving. Where the blood will go then? Last question from palpation. What do you feel, apex is LV type or RV type in your description?
Sir, RV type.
It's an RV type of apex?
Yes.
Retracting laterally, no?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, sir, Surago, sir.
Okay. I think that's a good discussion. We'll start from that palpation slide itself because I usually go with the slides so that we can touch upon all the points. The apex. What contributes to the apex normally? Normally, apex is contributed by the LV during which phase of cardiac cycle? It is mainly the isometric contraction phase, where in the isometric contraction phase, the LV moves counterclockwise and it touches. And after the initial ejection, it goes inward. So sustained apex can occur when there is a prolonged isometric contraction time or an early ejection is prolonged. So that is a thing which you have to tell. Second is, I usually am not happy with this lateral retraction. I have never picked up these things, but I said every time student talk about medial retraction and lateral retraction. Okay, I will accept it because that has been brought. Now the point is in tetralogy of Fallot, what is a precordium like? It is a quiet precordium. So because you want to put it as RV apex, you are putting it as lateral retraction. There is extrapolation. I have an idea. For me, it is difficult to pick up this medial retraction, lateral retraction, especially when there is no cardiomegaly. And in tetralogy of Fallot, if it is your diagnosis, usually it is a quiet precordium. So that is one thing which I'm not very happy. Then next slide, can you go to the next slide?
Yes, yes.
Percussion, rather than stretching like this, you straight away sir, situs is solitus. Because we are postgrad, we are dealing with postgraduates. We need not put it like this, tympanic node, left hypochondrium, dull node, right hypochondrium, and upper lower border is percussed down. So you say situs solitus. So that is what we want straight away. Okay, that's a most important thing in cyanotic analysis. We are mainly interested in the situs. Second left mucous space is resonant. That all you can say, but these are all difficult things. Next slide. Auscultation, S2 single without respiratory variation. Fine. When you say S2 single, that means there is no respiratory variation. If there is a respiratory variation, it is not single. When you say single, it is single during inspiration and expiration. So that you can modify. Single, is it normal or loud? That you have to say. There's a single second sound can be normal or loud. When then you will get a question, how can you say it is loud when it is single? Now we may say it is our auditory experience over years, but you can't say that. So the simple thing is you can auscultate over the apex beat. Over the apex beat, normally you hear first sound louder than the second sound. So if the second sound is louder than the first sound over the apex beat, you can say it is loud. But many times it is our, we know that the second sound will be loud. You have said no S3, S4 or other sounds. But which are the important sounds in this case? Are you expecting S3?
No. No, sir.
Are you expecting S4?
No. No, sir.
But what are you looking for? That is the important thing.
Ejection click.
You should say no ejection click. Okay, second is the murmurs, you have to add. What are the negative things in the murmurs? Which are the negative things you have to say in this case?
It is.
Specifically look for early diastolic murmur, then continuous murmur in the lung fields, and maybe in this case, apical MDM also, because there are certain conditions where you can have MDM also. So what you have to say is, sir, S1 is normal, S2 is single and loud or normal in intensity. Sir, there are no additional sounds like clicks. The murmur you have to describe, I'll come to the murmur. No EDM, no continuous murmur in the lung fields or no MDM. That you can complete. Now coming to the murmur. Okay, radiating the, all those you have said. Diaphragm stethoscope in sitting position and leaning forward, that is only for aortic regurgitation. Sitting up, leaning forward is only for aortic regurgitation, where the murmur is so faint that you want to hear that. There is no, why should the increase on sitting up, leaning forward in this position? On sitting up, the venous return comes down. So the murmur should come down in intensity. I may ask a question, why it is increasing? Because I've heard many times, even aortic stenosis murmur also, the sitting up, leaning forward is only for AR because the murmur is so faint. That is the reason. Now, otherwise, I will ask you why the murmur is best heard in sitting position. What is the mechanism? You will find it difficult to answer. On sitting up, the venous return comes down. So the murmur should come down, except the murmurs of the other two entities. And now you said that at held expiration, that is not needed. There the problem comes. What is this murmur due to?
It is because of RVOT obstruction, sir.
Then why do you say it is heard at expiration? Then comes what are the questions that are likely? What are the maneuvers which you will do in this case? That is a problem. In dynamic auscultation, which is the murmur you have to do? This murmur will definitely increase with?
With increasing, squatting.
Squatting, yes. Because that is the important thing. Physiologically. Because on squatting, the pulmonary blood flow is increasing. The murmur is increasing. So that will be more relevant in this case. Your problem is you will be grilled for that sitting question, what is the mechanism? Why it should be held at expiration? That is for AR only. Okay, then regarding dynamic auscultation you are doing, all are important, but not very important in this case, but the more physiological counterpart will be squatting. Squatting, the murmur increases because the pulmonary blood flow is increasing. And earlier we were asked to do that also and do the oxygen saturation also. You can find that oxygen saturation also improves. Then in the nervous system, I usually write NAD. What is the specific thing you look for in the nervous system, which sir, you might not have? Did you look at the fundus? Most likely no.
No, sir. No,
that's the most important thing in this case. So what we are looking at is each areas, what are the things you are looking for? In the respiratory system, obviously you are looking for continuous murmur in the lung fields. Gastrointestinal system, nothing gross in this case. Nervous system, you have to look for the reflexes to see whether there was some subtle evidences of a stroke or a paradoxical. The fundus you have to look for. Can you go to the first slide examination? Because we always take these points, conscious oriented, all those things you say that. Now, next, all these, everything, there will be a question. What is the shape, back and spine normal? What is the importance of that? You should know that. That is chest deformities or skeletal deformities and its association with Kanya disease. Regarding syndromic features, you know something. But spine deformity is more common in conotruncal abnormalities. Classically in tetralogy of Fallot, they have hemivertebra producing kyphoscoliosis. So those things are important. Next slide. Regarding the blood pressure, next slide. Blood pressure. You said 110 by 70. You recorded? Method of recording?
This is oscillometric, automatic.
Oscillometric, not the manual you have recorded.
No, sir.
Okay. It is better learned because this is a 12-year-old boy. In infants and children, it is okay. The pulse oximeter limitations in the toes, upper limb, what is the influence of the skin, all those things. There are limitations in that. So there are limitations in the pulse oximetry in the lower limbs also, because it is the reflection and that mechanism they will ask you. When you are recording in the lower limb, usually we see that you say that when there is AR, lower limb 110-72, they will ask you how you recorded. We need only the systolic pressure in the lower limb. Okay. JVP. JVP, try to get away from JVP at the earliest. Okay. You will be grilled on JVP. Each thing, normal and pulsatile. Why do you say pulsatile? When you say JVP normal, it has conveyed everything. And pulsatile, what is the importance of that?
Sir, in certain conditions with raised JVP, there can be non-pulsatile.
JVP,
like sir, Glenn shunt or Fontan operation or that is SVC
Glenn
syndrome.
Fontan operation, Glenn shunt, okay.
SVC obstruction or compression from the outside can also.
Here you want to rule out Fontan, but may not be relevant because the child had not undergone. Normal ANVS and X descent at 30 degrees, that is the problem. Why, from where did you get this 30 degrees? Now, you know the answer, but I say that what I want to tell is you can avoid certain mistakes and avoid questions from us. Why this 30 degrees?
Lying down position, wait at 30.
I'll put it like this. You need not try to either 45 degrees or nowadays it is sitting up. What is the method of examination of the AVP? For cardiology postgraduate, it is sitting up. Legs hanging down, abdominal clutch loosens. That is a standard and reference is the root of the clavicle. It's very clear. Or the MBBS or MD, you can go for 45 degree. Anyway, we are not going back. We are then abdominal jugular reflex is flat or negative. What do you mean by flat? What do you mean by negative?
Sir, when the after giving the pressure into the abdomen,
Where you are giving the pressure?
Sir, with the palm of the hand, we are giving the pressure at the center of the abdomen.
Okay, periumbilical region. Okay. Yeah.
We are giving for 15 seconds. And then we look for any increase and sustainability of the JVP. Okay. If there is more than 3 cm increase with
fine.
More than 15.
That is jugular abdominal reflex, sir, there is a sustained elevation. Rather than saying positive or negative, it is positive, you can say. But what do you mean by flat? I have never heard that. That's the reason why I'm
In some textbook, it has been described like there is a four kind of reflex.
No, when you say some textbooks, you should be careful, like postgraduate level, because I have faced this problem during my examination. It should be standard reference book, or you should have the original article quoted. That is a problem. When you say something which is not familiar with the examiners, and if you are quoting, it should be standard textbooks. Okay, you know what are the standard textbooks. Okay, not anyway the textbook written by me. Or you have to quote the reference for that quoting. If it is quoted in a textbook, which is a little odd, you have to quote the
Sir.
What do you mean by negative?
Sir, that is, it has not rise and it was not sustained. So
what
it was
is
being...
the most important information you get from abdominal jugular reflex? Is it positive or negative?
Yes. So patient, if a patient is having the negative, then the RV is well contracting and there is no RV dysfunction. If there is
negative means, is it normal or because I'll put it like
normal,
this, what I want.
Normal.
Now I want to put it like this. Sir, the jugular, you know, abdominal jugular reflex, it's a normal, it rises and falls in a few cycles. It is sustained elevation positive. I have a case where I pushed the abdomen, the JVP has not come up. What are the possibilities?
Sir, when there is a IVC obstruction.
Hypovolemia. Hypovolemia is the first thing.
Yes, sir.
Hypovolemia is the commonest. Second is vena cava obstruction. Either SVC obstruction or
Budachary syndrome or...
Okay. SVC obstruction or IVC obstruction. So a negative means with a normal JVP visible, if there is no abdominal jugular reflex, then that means the IVC is obstructed. Because when there is SVC obstructed, as you have seen, it will be grossly elevated and it will be non-pulsatile. You may find a normal JVP, normal waveform, but abdominal compression doesn't rise. It is an IVC obstruction. So vena cava obstruction negative. Okay, these things we should be very clear. I took you to that discussion because of those statements. 30 degrees and flat. I have never heard a flat. Negative we don't use because we don't know what is in your mind when you say it is negative. Okay, that's the thing which I want to discuss. So next slide.
Can I just say two
points? Yes, please.
One is that you did not mention in BP which cuff you use, either appropriate cuff or adult cuff, first one. Second, if you use an adult cuff and in a thigh, then the diastolic pressure is always equal. So as Sir already said, that only systolic would have been sufficient because diastolic pressure anywhere in the body will be equal. So if you are using, but if you're appropriately using an appropriate cuff and you are using auscultatory method, then only you should write diastolic. Second is that, as Sir has nicely said, if you say at 30 degree, you have looked for the waveforms, not at 45, that means the patient is already dehydrated. You have to make him flat to see the venous waveforms. So in that situation, actually, JVP is negative or is lower, then hyperjugular reflex is never tested because already JVP is negative. So you can mention in your point that, yes, JVP is already negative or lower than normal because you have to make him 30 degree or even have to make flat to see the waveforms. In that situation, hepatojugular reflex or abdominal jugular reflex will be mostly negative. That is the only point that was. Now going to the auscultation slide, I just want to say few points. One is, as Sir already has said, ejection click would have been the point that you should have mentioned, but you did not mention at all, and seems it is not there. Okay, next point is that, as already Sir has said, there are three types of murmur: low frequency, high frequency, and mixed or medium frequency. Mixed or medium frequency is the easiest murmur to hear. And this obstruction murmur is a mixed or mixed frequency ejection murmur. So here, special measures are not at all required. Most difficult murmurs are high frequency murmurs. That's why AR murmur, you make it sitting, leaning forward, and reduce the space between the origin of murmur and the stethoscope. That's why breath held in expiration, so that the space between these two, origin of murmur and your listening device, is minimum, bare minimum, and there is no sound, external sound. High frequency sounds require special methods, maneuvers to listen. Mixed frequency never requires anything. So that's why Sir already emphasized you is this point. This should be properly, that You can go for silent this one because you are expecting a little longer murmur. That's okay. But point of expression was not required. And the last point I want to say is that you said that murmur is very short, but how short, occupying how much, that you did not mention at all. So because severity of cough will be based on your this only murmur. So whether it is occupying one third, half, that I would have expected because it's a descriptive term. So brief is what?
It is early systolic only.
And where is the murmur arising? Origin of the murmur?
Sir, origin of the murmur, the third left intercostal space. And it was...
From heart sound, when it is arising? From S1, after S1?
Huh? After S1, sir.
How after? After a brief period?
Yes, sir.
One theoretical question I'll ask you. This patient has got a right ventricular hypertrophy and there is sinus rhythm. Why not S4? What are the things that is needed for S4, production of an S4?
That is, sir, increase the right ventricular end-diastolic pressure. So, atria has to contract more. Forcefully during the late part of the diastole, which will produce S4.
So why not here? What is the condition that is withholding from happening an S4?
So right ventricular end diastolic pressure in cough is not elevated and such.
Why is it not elevated? So, it has got the outflow obstruction. It has got significant hypertrophy. What prevents in having an elevated RVEDP?
Due to VHD, sir, large VHD.
Decompression, but that is systolic.
I got the answer from Sudhir.
Systolic, that is VHD will decompress during the systole. It will not cause the diastole. So diastolic. Can be possible that S4 can be there.
So one part of the answer is already Sumud has given. When you hinder is a VHD, so there is always an outlet. So the outlet may be problem. Second is that in tetralogy, always this RA is small. So RA, unless RA is large and pressure volume is significant, here volume is less in the right side. So that's why, because majority of, again, volume is going to the left side through the VHD. So again, coming back, because you have used again the 30-degree position, that means the JVP is not, RA even is not full. That indicates that volume is not is significant. So every other thing is there, but volume is not there to push significant blood to produce an S4. So that is, okay, sir, go.
I'll just add to that, one of the important physiological thing is, when there is RVH with an intact IVS, you get... prominent AV. If there is RVH and RV can decompress with a non-restrictive VSD, or when the RV pressure is only systemic or subsystemic, RV pressure is suprasystemic, you will get that. So the other points which you have said. So here it is because of the non-restrictive VSD. That's why in Eisenmenger VSD also you won't get prominent AV. You can get it later, but that's not the classical thing. Okay, now we go to the diagnosis, how to approach the diagnosis. I will give you some clue. Now we have got some idea about the physiology of this case. The physiology of this case, all of us agree that the pulmonary blood flow is reduced. So that we know. So there is an obstruction to flow of the blood, that is pulmonary stenosis at valvular or subvalvular level, whatever it is there. Now we have to look at the anatomical segmental. What is the situs? That is a thing. What is the ventricle like? What is the great artery like? Okay, situs we know. Now, is it a situs? Then is it levocardia, dextrocardia, or whatever it is? That is very clear. When you are going for the diagnosis, the first thing is situs, solitus, levocardia. Okay, that you can put straight away. Then for making the diagnosis, what is the ventricle like? Is it RV dominance, LV dominance, or both ventricular important, or biventricular? Similarly, the great arteries, are they normally related or abnormally related? Is it a hypertensive pulmonary artery, normotensive, very unlikely, or a hypotensive or oligemic? So this is what we have to approach. And where is the aortic arch? There are some clues clinically about aortic arch also, but it is difficult. For example, the right aortic arch in a child, you may get pulsations of the right sternoclavicular joint, something like this. So this is the next step. That is cytosolitis levocardia. Heart size we have mentioned. Is it RV dominance, LV dominance, or biventricular? Then are vessels normally related or not? What is the pulmonary artery? Is it a hypertensive or normal or hypotensive? So that should be your approach to make the diagnosis. Based on this analysis, you have to come to the differential diagnosis. Okay. So based on this, we have found that cytosolitis levocardia. Which ventricle is dominant?
Sir, RV dominant.
RV. So we consider a cyanotic congenital disease with reduced pulmonary blood flow and RV dominance. What is the vessel relation? Is it L post aorta?
No, sir.
Is it likely or not?
It is less likely, sir, because in percussion and palpation, the second left intercostal space was...
No. What is the clinical finding of a classical L post aorta? You need not percuss. It will be prominent pulsations mimicking pulmonary artery, but it will be in the second and third phase and a little away from the parasternal region.
Yes.
And aortic component may be palpated because it is relatively anterior. So we at present know that cytosolitis, levocardia, RV dominance, and there is no L post aorta. That's all the information we have. Based on that, you have to tell the differential diagnosis. That is the way I approach this case. Okay. So come to the different diagnosis. Yes, sir.
Yeah, go to differential diagnosis. So what you have in your mind after all this examination and history taking, everything, what are the things that you want to limit now?
Sir, I want to limit to two things. One is classical tetralogy of Fallot and other DURB, VSD, PS.
DURB, VSD?
PS. Yes.
So these two, or you single ventricle is there in your list, or it's out? RV type, single ventricle RV type is there, or it is out of the list?
Sir, I will keep it on third list, single ventricle. But as the patient is having the age is 12 years, so it is very less likely to survive.
No, the single ventricle with pulmonary stenosis can survive. It is extremely difficult to differentiate. There is one thing which can survive. Okay, because tetralogy of Fallot also is physiologically a single ventricle. So single ventricle, there is no problem. It depends on other factors. Okay. Then can it be detransfusion of great arteries with a VSD, PS?
Yes.
That's also possible. Can it be tricuspid atresia, VSD, PS?
So we are in the RV dominant and RV type of apex. So
and don't... The murmur will be relatively long. Long murmur, disparity between cyanosis and the length of the murmur. That will be a very useful thing. When you find there is a disparity between the degree of cyanosis and the length of the RVOT murmur, you have to definitely look for complex cases, provided there is no anemia. Make sure that the patient's hemoglobin is okay. That is the limitation in this. So when you find there is a disparity between the degree of cyanosis and the length of the outflow murmur, then you have to look for other things also. Okay, fine. Go ahead.
Can we have the next ECG?
No. We have to say how to differentiate. I say this is DURV with PS.
Okay.
What are some of the points which are useful?
Sir, patient will be having the cyanosis usually from birth.
Because if you take DURV, by definition, it's more than 50% overwrite, which is equivalent to a severe tetralogy of Fallot. And aortic mitral continuity doesn't influence the physiology. So it may not be very, the classical DURV with PS will be extremely difficult based on that. But the location of the obstruction is more at the valvular level in DURV than at the infundibular level. There is a one useful thing, the murmur will be relatively higher up. You may be able to hear the P2. These are some of the things which I have learned.
Murmur is out of proportion to cyanosis.
That you can have, you need not have, because if you look at that, DURV, VSD, PS by the classical definition and a severe tetralogy of Fallot, apart from the anatomical differences of side-by-side relation, aorto mitral continuity, physiology is almost the same. So there should not be much difference otherwise. only soft findings. ECG is useful. Okay, sir, your points, some points you have.
Yeah.
We have Dr. Gupta, Dr. Sumuth, keeping mum.
Sumuth to add something.
Okay.
Yeah,
so, as sir has said that in DORB murmur can be little higher up also, sometimes even P2 second component is very faintly audible also because of that, because most of the time it is valvular, so infundibular is not impeding, so sometimes you can hear a faint P2. So if it is two component hard actually, then most of the people believe that it may be actually a valvular level obstruction, so it can be DORB.
Just I want to add one point to an earlier question. LV apex in cyanotic heart disease, we have said about tricuspid atresia, single ventricle, but pulmonary atresia with intact interventricular septum, Epstein's anomaly with an ASD, all these things can have. Theoretically, I have not seen, because pulmonary atresia with intact interventricular septum less likely to survive. But they survive because of a good intra-atrial communication and good iota-pulmonary communication. They will have an LV effect. Then the other thing, Epstein's. Severe Epstein with a large ASD, right to left shunting. Again, the whole majority of the blood will come to the left heart. So they can have. So these are the situations. Then truncus arteriosus is one situation where you can, because many times they will have AR also, truncal regurgitation also. You have said about tetralogy of Fowler with all the conditions. You have said that is very good. You have said they are all those things. Fine. Go ahead.
So even in cases of tetralogy also, or even in DORB, if you have got excessive collaterals, then also sometimes LV may be this one. So
that he has said
very rare. So
PDA, aorta pulmonary collapses, AR. Okay.
Yeah.
One more thing. Endocardial cushion defect, sir. Down syndrome with tetralogy.
Yeah. That's right. Okay.
Although DORV with the VSTPS, you know, the discordance between the cyanosis and murmur in general, and we expect that the more cyanosis, less murmur. But I think the disproportion thing mainly happens because when there is a restrictive VST, you know, DORV with restrictive VST with if there is FPS, probably then the murmur can be harsh and then they can be still having cyanosis.
Okay, fine. Yeah.
Sir, in that case, if there is a restrictive VST with DORV, then murmur of the VST will not be there because both the murmur will be systolic, I think.
Yeah, that's the murmur that then you will be detecting. No, that murmur, harsh murmur will be detected as, that may be the reason why there is harsh murmur and more cyanosis. Because it's an obligatory flow. And that murmur has to be heard anyway. One more thing I want to say in your examination finding, why did you write expression? Right sided murmurs increase on expression? Any of the right sided murmurs increase on expression? You told that right sided murmur was on held expression, it is increasing. Normally, what happens to right sided murmurs on expression?
So normally,
in which phase of the cardiac cycle does right sided murmurs increase?
Normally during the inspiration, right-sided murmur increases, but one condition like pulmonary valvular stenosis with ejection click, which actually decreases with inspiration.
Yeah, that is about the ejection click.
Yes.
But yeah, the ejection click and murmur is different. Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. I think I'll help. He'll not help you. When the question comes, we have to study the question. Okay. So that you can avoid mistakes. The question was, what are the conditions where the right-sided murmurs increase with expiration, inspiration? Now, which are the left-sided murmurs will be better heard during expiration? Now, the question is, which are the left-sided murmurs which are better heard during inspiration?
Sir, that is HOCM and MVP murmur.
MVP murmur. Okay, yes. Fine.
HOCM.
Can you tell me a very difficult question? Nothing related to congenital. I want to give you distinction once you got a clearance. Pass idale, only after getting a pass you will get distinction. Okay. Now, can you tell me a right-sided murmur which is decreasing with inspiration? Okay. You can ask all the other PGs and try to get the answer and pass it to Dr. Gupta, Sumod or somebody later. Okay. Fine. Go ahead. You want ECG, X-ray? Usual monotonous question. Okay.
ECG.
That's a question which is monotonous. I never ask that question because both are contributory, but in certain cases it will be definite. ECG, go ahead. Before that, what you are looking in the ECG? That's important.
Sir, in ECG,
what
I would like...
I see is only what mine knows.
Sir, so, I would like...
Please make co-host Dr. Pandey sharing, Dr. Dhanjay.
Yes, sir.
Please make Dr. Pandey co-host.
Sir, I would like to differentiate between DURV and TOF.
Are the things you are going to look for in the ECG to make the differential diagnosis? Okay. Yes. What about Pandey?
Sir, sharing the ECG.
Yeah. Now, before going to that electrocardiogram, what are the things you are going to look for to differential diagnosis?
Sir, one, I will go with the right axis deviation.
Axis you look for.
One that is
where the problem you look for. Fine.
Then what is the loop that is counterclockwise?
Loop, I think you should be careful with the senior teachers of the previous generation or my generation because loop is entirely different when vector cardiogram was done. Still, you can talk about loop, but this loop is not what the original loop means. Okay, with my colleagues may agree, but okay, you can look for the loop.
Whether say whether the which ventricle is dominant?
Which ventricle is dominant?
Whether what is the sir transition level?
Transition, all those things, and how to differentiate the two clinical differential diagnoses? Because one, are you expecting something which is beyond your expecting? Because basically, we are trying to differentiate tetralogy of Fallot versus DURV. Do you have any points to differentiate that when it presents with tetralogy of Fallot physiology? That is the first thing you have to look for because that is our DD. And second, you find surprise it doesn't belong to tetralogy of Fallot. That is the way. Is it compatible? If it is compatible, how to differentiate? That is the way you have to approach an ECG. We have two different diagnoses. How to differentiate that? What are the points you look for?
Sir,
if it is not there, what is the other thing? Okay, go ahead.
In the top, there is a right axis deviation which is between 90 to 120 degree.
Yeah.
But more than 150 degree is possible in DURV.
That is it. Very good, very good. Second.
Other thing it is, sir, on ECG that is counterclockwise loop in case of DURV.
When it comes to tetralogy of Fallot physiology, it is extremely uncommon, that loop, the original loop. Okay.
So in top, there is a clockwise. In DURV, there is counterclockwise.
There need not be counterclockwise. Okay. By the electrocardiogram which you are measuring, it need not be in this case. Okay, fine.
Other thing.
Then,
sir.
Look at V5, V6. Deep S waves, very unlikely in tetralogy of Fallot.
Yes.
Whereas you can have the classical pattern, but V6 doesn't show deep S waves in tetralogy of Fallot. That means a gross RVH pattern is less likely. I don't know the mechanism. Gross RVH pattern is less likely with it is more likely. Gross RVH pattern is more likely with DURV, that is an axis which is more towards the right, like 150, and deep S in V5, V6. Okay, fine.
ECG, which is taken with the normal standardization and regular paper speed of 25 mm per second.
Okay, go ahead.
In that, we can see a 12 lead ECG where there is a rate is approximately
fine. Rhythm? 60.
Rhythm, there is a sinus arrhythmia.
Very good.
And there is a normal PQRST relationship.
This is a phasic sinus arrhythmia or a non-phasic sinus arrhythmia?
Phasic, sir.
No, you don't have the...
Respiratory.
Without that, that's the way you have to answer because you have conveyed. You know the answer. Says there is no the respiratory, capnograph in that. Okay, fine.
And sir, axis, there is a biphasic wave in the AVR.
You tell the axis.
There is, sir, axis is 120 degree positive. That is right axis deviation.
120 or a little less than 120 because AVR is more negative. AVR is more negative, so it has to be less than 120 because that's a one thing we take. Usually in tetralogy of Fallot, it will be less than 120. And 120 to 150, it is borderline. So less than 120. Okay, fine.
And sir, there is a Q waves in 3 AVF with RS pattern in 1 AVF suggestive of clockwise loop.
You didn't realize that I am not happy with the clock. That is one thing. You should study the mind of the examiner also. Okay.
Yes, sir.
From the very beginning, I am telling that I am not very happy with the diagnosis of the loop based on Q wave alone. Okay, fine. Go ahead. No problem.
sir, in from the precordial leads, there is a V1 where there is a dominant R wave is there with the RS ratio that is more than 1. And there is progression of the QRS. It is reversed. That is, and there is sudden transition at the level of V2. So predominantly RV forces with early transition from precordial leads, sir.
Is this compatible with your diagnosis of tetralogy of Philo or DOR? Which will you prefer?
Sir, classical TOF I will prefer.
Likely. What is the likely RV systolic pressure in this case?
Sir, there is 1, 2, 3, 4. That is...
You are in trouble now. The question is very simple.
Because, sir, there is a VSD is there, so RV cannot be suprasystemic.
No,
so
I didn't ask anything. I asked a question, what is the RV systolic pressure? Yeah, precise. You know the answer. You know the answer. You tell the value.
Or sir, there is from the sir, blood pressure
you
we can
tell
get.
The value. You tell the value. You score more marks.
110.
You say it is sir systemic, 110.
110.
You use the term, sir, this is systemic RV pressure, 110 in this case.
Yes.
So that is the best way. The exam will be impressed. You will get an additional 5 marks. Okay. Now, do you think without this thing, you don't know, I have not given you the blood case. From this electrocardiogram, what is the likely RV systolic pressure? Is it systemic, subsystemic, suprasystemic?
RV pressure, sir, should be systemic.
Why? Systemic or subsystemic? Why?
Subsystemic. Because, sir, it will effectively decompress, so it cannot reach beyond suprasystemic.
Yeah, I'm talking about electrocardiogram.
What is asking from ECG, not ECG.
From ECG. Okay, in ECG, there is a dominant RV.
There is RVH. There is RVH.
And there is RVH. And
okay. How much is the pressure?
How much? Is it suprasystemic or not?
No, sir.
Why?
If there is a QR pattern in the V1, then it will give suprasystemic with T inversion.
Strain pattern in right chest leads in the absence of digitalis or electrolyte imbalance. You have to tell all those things. Okay. Absence of STT changes in the right chest leads in the absence of drugs like digoxin, electrolyte imbalance like that. Okay. You complete that, you will score more marks. Okay, fine. Sir?
Also, question I was asked about from ECG, sir was asking you how much is around pressure because he said large VSD. So you took the point that your blood pressure was so that you said. But otherwise, if you get this ECG, and suppose in the spotting, how much is the RV pressure? That was the question.
From the spotter, sir, 20 into 500. That is a 20 small square into 5, so almost 100.
Okay.
Again, that formula is classically described for valvular pulmonary
stenosis
with intact IVS. Okay, fine. But you are right.
So what are the top physiologies that excludes by this ECG? Quickly, just recap.
Sir, TOF with that is pulmonary atresia.
Okay.
And TOF.
Sir, pulmonary atresia.
How you excluded TOF with pulmonary atresia?
It will be sir. XCC is usually normal in pulmonary atresia, and there is predominantly LV forces.
That you are talking about pulmonary atresia. When you talk about pulmonary atresia, unspecified, we mean pulmonary atresia with VSD.
Intake ventricular septum, you are not going to get up to 12 years of age with all these things. So we are saying that VSD pulmonary atresia. So why are you excluding from this ECG?
Sir, because...
No, you can't exclude. Okay, fine. What are the things excluded straight away?
Yeah, go next. Sir. I am asking you what are the diseases you definitely can exclude by seeing this ECG.
There is DORB, one I am excluding. One, it is AV.
You cannot exclude
that. Less likely, you can put TOF ahead of URV.
Tricuspid atresia.
Yeah.
One is tricuspid atresia.
One is Epstein anomaly.
Okay, but when you are talking about TOF like physiologies?
Or third?
Single ventricle.
Yeah, single ventricle. Okay, good. Then based on the axis.
Based on axis, sir, TGA, TGNT, or both are.
So what happens to CCTGA?
CCTGA, sir, there is a reverse of the ventricular inversion is there. So there will be absence of Q waves in V5, V6.
So you are not excluding CCTG, PS. So that's the one definitely. Excluded. What happens to tricuspid atresia with Milpous gate arteries? What happens to axis or the ECG? Tricuspid atresia with Milpous gate arteries, transpose gate arteries.
If you are not sure, say I'm not sure.
Not sure. Okay.
But the other thing which you can exclude is AV canal defects which presents
AV canal defects.
So that's why I gave you a clue for axis. You look at the axis. Yes. So these are some of the things you straight away say. First, all the examinations on tricuspid atresia, single ventricle. Then you can say AV canal defect with the tetralogy pulmonary stenosis. So those are the things which you can. Epstein's anomaly, obviously, physiologically, we are not considering Epstein's anomaly clinically also. So you can put it last in the list. Okay, fine. Yes, sir. Shall we go to X-ray?
Go to X-ray, yeah.
Dr. Pandey, X-ray, please. Dr. Pandey?
Wait a second, sir.
Dr. Sumo, do you want to contribute to ECG in ECG?
Yeah, that's fine, sir. They will ask the cause of transition in why this transition,
yeah.
LV filling, how do you assess the LV filling, all those things we can provide. So I think that are common questions there.
That is common, that is known, and you already taught. That's why I did not ask.
Sir, there is a
generally in the earlier lectures that we had from many of the experts, there was a lot of debate about the cause for the early transition.
See, so I don't ask this question to the students. Yeah. So there is controversy. There are so many other things to ask, which are straightforward. Yeah. The sudden transition, people said that it is because of the displacement of the interventricular septum. So that what is happening is in V1, V2, there is a window so that the V2 is picking up the some forces. I'm not happy with this answer. So I never asked that question to the students.
But what, as examiner, what you expect answer? So if you ask me, I expect the answer that because of the large VSD, the posterior your LV forces picks up. So that's why it goes up. But the question more important is whether a student is intelligent or not is, suppose there is no transition. So whether it is TOF or not, classical TOF or not. Suppose there is no transition ECG. We get so many patients. There is no transition. So if you can answer, I'll give you credit, Danji. There is no transition, but the case is TOF. CAT bhi ho gaya. So mood ne CAT karke bhi confirm kar diya. It's a TOF. But transition tumko nahi mila. What can be the cause?
Sir, VSD location and size may be different.
So your answer should be transition can happen even before V1. Okay. So if you take one more space rightward, you may get transition. Okay. So your answer should have been that lead position has to be proper to pick up the transition. So it can happen at V1. So previous lead may have had a very taller RUA, but you missed it. So that's why. Answer should be that it can happen even before V1 also. So that's why transition can happen at V1 or for that you have to take one more lead. So these are the important questions are important thinking. Go to X-ray.
Yes, sir. Chest X-ray PM where there is there is adequate exposure without rotation and good inspiratory film. Where we can see that is
put it. The standard X-ray is mid expiratory, so don't say good inspiratory film. The standard X-ray is mid expiratory. Okay, you are reasonably happy, so you need not bother about that. Okay,
yeah.
Some examiners will get also will ask question on that.
Gastric fundus on the that air bubble is
put it straight away. Don't beat around the bush. Situs solitus levocardia.
Okay, so situs solitus levocardia. Cardiothoracic ratio appears to be less than 0.5. There is no cardiomegaly or there is obvious chamber enlargement. Apex appears to be RV type with upturned apex. And in the main pulmonary artery segment, there is a concavity and the aortic knob is visible. And from the bronchus, that is right-sided bronchocity is more straight and broader and short.
That you have said situs solitus. When you say at postgraduate level situs solitus, we presume that. That you have looked into the bronchus, all those things. And that is why, because as a postgraduate, be very precise, you score more marks. Okay. So when I say cytosolitis, then levocardia, if I'm interested, I will ask you, why do you say cytosolitis? Then you have to answer all those things. Otherwise, you need, because we have so many other things to discuss in this case. Okay. Right. That is the way you have to go. We have said the main problem there. Your aortic knob is seen. That's not the important thing here.
Mm-hmm. And what is sir, main that is a pulmonary vascularity.
No, and I will come back. Aortic knob, what is the important thing? Suppose you want to mention something about the aortic knob.
Sir, we can increase pulmonary blood flow, will increase the...
No, you have to say that, sir, arch is on the left side or right side.
Arch is on the left
side. To the point, score more marks. All the other things I was happy, cytosolitis, levocardia, no cardiomegaly, RV apex, MPA is concave. When you say aortic knob, it's not fair. You can say the arch is on the left side. Then you will get questions on that. Then go ahead. Then you go to the pulmonary vasculature.
The pulmonary vasculature appears to be reduced.
Okay,
and
why? Why do you say it is reduced? Because we are anticipating that. Okay. How will you say it is reduced?
Sir, lateral one-third part of the...
First thing is measure the right pulmonary artery.
Right pulmonary.
When the pulmonary blood flow is reduced, the central pulmonary arteries have to be small. That is the number one measurable thing. Okay. So you have to measure the pulmonary artery size. And you should know what is the normal for this A group. And where will you measure? At which point? It is the right descending pulmonary artery at the origin of the lower bronchus. In this case, it is very clearly seen. You can see that, I can't demonstrate this from my slide. You can see that the upper lobe bronchus as well as the lower lobe bronchus. You can see that junction very clearly in this. And you have to measure the diameter of that. In this child, anything less than 12 millimeter has to be taken as small. So you say that even if you have not measured, you have to say that the RPA. What about the LPA in this case? You can see the LPA very clearly in this case. Why? You don't see that. Normally, it is masked by the normally dilated pulmonary artery. Okay, here the main pulmonary artery is small, so you are seeing that. Okay. Now, you look at the size. So, before saying that the pulmonary vasculature is normal, reduced or increased, you talk about the pulmonary artery. Sir, the main pulmonary artery segment is concave. The right pulmonary artery seems to be small and the vessels are attenuated and in the periphery only scanty vessels. There are no end-on vessels. That is the way you have to describe because we are interested more in the pulmonary vasculature and other anatomy. So that presentation is very important. Regarding the pulmonary vasculature, sir, the main pulmonary artery is not seen. The RPA is small. The central pulmonary artery branches are very thin and the periphery, the vessels are scanty. There are no end-on vessels suggesting a reduced pulmonary blood flow or pulmonary oligemia. Second, is it symmetric or not? That also is very important. Are you seeing it symmetric or asymmetric? Because that is important. Seeing the nodularity of aortopulmonary collaterals?
Yes, these are the things
which you have to look for. Okay.
In the right lower lobe area, we can see there is some reticular pattern is there.
Not very much convinced. Okay, fine.
So, possibility of sir associated aortopulmonary collateral.
That is why you should read the mind of the examiner. Did you hear what I said? No, that is very important in the examination. Okay. As an examiner, I am denying. But not like that. I told you that I am not convinced. Okay. So don't again say that it's aorta pulmonary collapse. Unless the other exam says, okay, you are right. So you should study the read the mind of the examiner also. Very important. Okay. Fine. Yes. Go ahead.
So what are the other findings in X-ray of significant aorta pulmonary collaterals?
Sir, pulmonary blood flow will be differential from one in both lungs. That in one lung it might give more and reticular pattern, lacy pattern will be visible in the pulmonary collaterals.
Segmental. It can not give whole lung. Okay. Any other? Quickly, any other?
In sir, LV that cardiomegaly can be there because of the predominantly.
I am not saying that collateral is such that now it is not TOF. I am saying that classical TOF, but there's significant, very tight PS and large AP collateral, which is generally are seen in 12-year-old. So what are the signs that you look for? One, you say that sir is not convinced. So that is one. We agreed that, okay, you look for. Second, you said that lacy pattern of a segment of a lung. That also I agree. Any other? Do you get sometimes notching of ribs also for collateral sometimes?
Sometimes you can get notching of the ribs, collaterals.
Some abnormal area notching can be sometimes visible because of large collaterals coming from that area. Then there can be PDA calcified sometimes so small PDA or PDA calcifications that can be seen. Okay, so any more point you want to?
Just one point. Yes, are you expecting collaterals in this case? Aortopulmonary collaterals in this case?
Yes, sir.
And very unlikely because what are the situation? One, collaterals occur when there is very inadequate native flow. The clue will be you find a short murmur suggesting a severe tetralogy of Fallot or a severe thing, but cyanosis is relatively less. That means this patient has cyanosis is related to the pulmonary blood flow, not based on the right to left shunt. That is why we concentrate on the pulmonary blood flow. So when you find by examination, there is very insignificant murmur, but the cyanosis is relatively less. You have to rule out anemia, that's a different thing. So classically it is seen when there is pulmonary atresia. If there is a forward flow, the chance of collaterals is relatively less. Okay. So these are the situations where you have to look for collaterals. Okay, fine. Go ahead.
Anything to add from X-ray?
I have the usual question is where is the arch?
Arch is on left side, sir.
Left side. You are in trouble now. Why do you say it is left?
Left arch, what is the reason?
Sir, that is indentation of trachea.
Is it there?
There is no definite indentation.
That's it. So you have to say, sir, the answer should be diplomatic. Sir, there is no definite indentation, but I can see the aortic knuckle and the proximal descending aorta on the left side. If you can see the aortic knuckle on the left side, that is a clue that the aortic arch is on the left side. Okay. But what we want is the indentation. So you have to talk like that rather than straight away saying, sir, there is no definite indentation on the left side. I can't see that. But sir, the knuckle and the proximal descending aorta is seen on the left side. So it's a left arch. So you give an impression that you will look for all the things. Okay.
Yes.
Fine. Echo.
So quickly, you show echo then.
And I just show the echo.
So how will you do the echo in this case?
Sir, we will first of all segmental approach that whether the situs solitus and look for the IVC and aorta, and then we will identify the ventricle atria, then identify the ventricles, and then we will connect with the great arteries.
Okay, fine.
And then we will look for, sir, VSD. And
look for the venous drainage also. Never forget to mention that also. Yes. Because the veno atrial concordance also has to be looked into, because we don't discuss those things. We talk about the visceral atrial, atrial ventricular and ventricular arterial. You have to look at the veno atrial concordance also. The venous drainage is very important. Never forget to look for the origin of the coronary arteries, at least the proximal coronaries also. Then you look for the structural abnormalities. Okay, good. Very good.
Yes, sir. In that, from the first echo,
can you make it, this is PowerPoint, can you make it slideshow? Can you ask them to put it slideshow? Okay, the echo, okay, fine.
Sir, in first echocardiography image, which is a color Doppler with 2D image, where we can see there is a pulsatile flow on the
left. This is a situs solitus.
Situs solitus.
Yes.
In the next. We can see there is a leocardia from this subcostal view.
Yes.
Next. Flex. Sir, it is a parasternal short axis view where we can see there is a main pulmonary artery dividing into the left and right, and they are confluent.
Yeah.
At the level of RVOT, there is a tissue which is causing obstruction and pulmonary.
You can't say that. You can't say that because you have seen the echo. That is a problem. This is the problem. You get the tip in the examination and you answer based on the tip. Because you cannot see much. Where is the obstruction? All those things from that. To me, it looked at the valvular level. That is what I was not sure, because the image, where is it taken? So we have to put the color, all those things. Then only you start reading. Otherwise, the examiner gets an impression that you have got the tip. Okay, fine.
In from the color image, we can see there is a starting of the turbulences at the RVOT level.
Yes.
And there is no further turbulence. So, and in the 2D image also, pulmonary wall appears normal.
Okay. And now, where is the pulmonary wall? Can you show where exactly? Mm-hmm. Okay. Now, mm-hmm. go to the previous one, because we know this is tetralogy of Fallot, the candidate knows. But then the candidate reads very fast, faster than what the examiner can comprehend. That is the problem which happens. Okay. Where is the pulmonary valve in this case, in the first picture? Then second, is the turbulence only at one level or two levels in the color? Because you read that without limitation.
So where here is the pulmonary valve?
Here that is the thing which you have to look into, because we are not seeing it. We can presume it is lower down, but you are not seeing the opening of the valves as such. But what you can see very well is there is a good sized confluent main pulmonary artery and two branches. That is important thing. There is a forward flow from the RVOT. So RVOT pulmonary artery connection is there. Continuity is there. Now the turbulence in the color Doppler has all limitations. You can't say it is confined to one side. For that, you have to interrogate with Doppler. Okay, fine.
That continuous Doppler image taken at the RVOT level, which is showing a dagger shape appearance with peak gradient 89.
Yes.
And in the second steel image, we can see there is a main pulmonary artery, and which is confluent with the left and right pulmonary artery, and good sized pulmonary arteries.
Now, where you have measured the pulmonary artery here?
Sir, they have measured at the origin.
Now right, distance from that to now. That's why I said in the previous one also, where did you show the valve? Where did you show that membrane? Okay, so a little better anatomical delineation in the short axis and a modified RVOT view. An RVOT view would have been there. What we have taken is a cross section showing the descending posterior pulmonary artery, and so outflow was not well defined, but we jumped to the conclusions. Okay, here you have measured, you measure that central pulmonary artery measurements according to you, what was that region? Okay, fine. Now, what is the relevance of this measurement?
Sir, for intracardiac repair, this size of the and confluence of the pulmonary artery is important.
When you have measured RPA and LPA, what is the importance of that? They will ask you about the Mechgone index, all those things, which are not done nowadays. When we are students, we are asked about Nakata, Mechgone, all those things. But you should read about that. Okay. Sir, now, are you convinced about the Doppler interrogation, or you would like to have a better interrogation? What would you like to have? Which signal you have, Doppler, continuous wave Doppler you have put, or something else? We want to know the cycle of obstruction, levels of obstruction, single level or multiple level. So you should interrogate the RV outflow tract in the modified view plus the cross-sectional view. You use the pulse Doppler also to analyze what are the sites of obstruction, which is very important in the surgical management. Okay.
Yes.
Now you look at the measurement which you have done. Okay, fine. Go ahead. What does it show?
Sir, apical four chamber view showing that RARV, that is tricuspid valve, which is septophilic, and there is a mitral valve.
Better will be if you want to
and normal.
Sir, this is a D loop of the ventricle. If you can put that, there will be extremely, you will get an additional 2 marks. D loop of the ventricle, because why? Then I know that you have gone through that. That is the tricuspid valve. Trabeculae, all those things, you say moderate band, all those things. You can see the moderate band also. So say, sir, this is a dual loop of the ventricle. Okay. Okay. Then?
Another image, Pandit.
Okay, you can say that the pulmonary veins are draining normally. Okay, fine. Very good.
Sir, apical five chamber view, which is showing that is the aorta, which is having the override at approximately 50%.
Okay, fine.
Okay.
You have the color. Okay, that color video.
Yes, the color is showing.
Excellent.
Yes.
What does it show?
It's showing that RV is flowing directly going into the aorta.
Not directly, RV. There is a right to left shunt. Because
right, right to left shunt.
It is emptying the pulmonary artery also.
Yes, sir.
Right to left. You have to look for AR. Is there any
there is no.
AR you have to look for? We have to look carefully for trivial AR also. Yes. Okay.
And sir, this is the suprasternal notch view, which is showing the normal arch, and there is no coarctation of aorta.
Will you look for reverse cellar flow?
Yes, sir. If there is, we are suspecting aortic regurgitation on first, then we can.
Not only that, if there is aortic runoff, what are the levels of aortic runoff that can occur in these types of cases?
And sir, aortic runoff can occur if there is a PDA is there associated. Mm-hmm. If there is a MAPCAS are there.
That's it. So you have to look not AR, AR alone. In this case, AR we have excluded. We are not. I am not expecting major MAPCAS in this case. So aortic runoff, you have to tell all those things. If there is a BT shunt, you can have. If there is a PDA, you can have. Major aortopulmonary collaterals, aortic runoff, all those things you can tell. Okay. Sometimes there can be anomalous origin of the pulmonary artery from the aorta. There is absent one pulmonary artery may be arising from the aorta, in which case there can be flow from the aorta to the pulmonary artery. That may be the clue. So you should know these things also if you want to score above 70 marks. Okay. Yes, I have been talking so far, sir. Dr. Nath, Sumo.
Yes, sir. No, absolutely. I am also learning from your this one. So echo shows to be classical tetralogy of Fallot, is not it?
If I can ask a question.
Yeah.
Banji, yes, how sir. Do you say about the sidedness of arch based on suprasternal view?
Based on the branching pattern, that is whether the first branch is that is innominate or and it will be bifurcating into two, that is right subclavian and the right common cavity. And then there will be single left common cavity and then left subclavian. So based on that, it
is. Okay, is there better. Anything related to the marking on the probe? How do you make out right side aortic arch?
Sir, based on some branching pattern, usually we
only branching. So you are in right, never goes the bacchographic fast is not the rule.
No, the question is, see, if you put the probe in the usual position in the suprasternal notch,
yes, sir.
How would you look? How will the right sided arch look? Will you look, will it look like an arch?
Or it will
that
look
is the question.
Like
if it looks like an arch, only then you will be able to know about the first branch, right?
Yes, sir.
So it will look like a cross section.
Cross sectional image. Cross.
Yes. If you change the position of probe to the opposite of the usual position, that is towards the right shoulder, notch towards the right shoulder instead of notch towards the left shoulder, then you might probably get a arch-shaped structure. So that is how you usually look into which is the sidedness of the arch.
So if you place in the suprasternal knots and if you position towards the left and if you see a cross sectional, then you change it to 90 degree. You make it 90 degree. And if you see a cross and then it is the right arch. So that's how it goes as Gries has nicely said. So,
what other congenital heart diseases can be diagnosed by suprasternal view?
In the suprasternal view, sir, the pulmonary venous drainage, can be made out from short axis, suprasternal short axis view. And other
what is that view called as?
Krebs view.
Krebs view. Good. Very good.
Other thing is, sir, we can make out the arch, that is a coarctation of aorta is there or not. Then.
Okay. And anything else?
Anomalous artery origin.
PDA?
Yes, sir. PDA, it is also better. And, sir, SVC, that is, we can also see there is, a vertical vein is coming, the flow is coming towards the probe in case of PA, PVC.
Good, very good.
Let me ask you, if you see suprasternal view and if you have not seen a vertical vein, so how you diagnose TA, PVC?
the flow in the SVC will be very much high in comparison.
How you assess the flow of SVC? You said high. What is normal? So how you assess the flow in SVC? Normal. How much is the normal velocity of flow in SVC?
Sir, actually, don't know.
Okay. So you'll read that point. Okay. The flow is correct, but how? What is the velocity in the pulse volume? So that will be okay. So, sir, we can summarize, or you want to go to CAT part?
Okay. I think we have more data. I think that is an interesting which I would like to contribute. Echo always with clinical.
Yeah.
Okay. Basically, as I discussed earlier, you should have a clinical workup. These are the different diagnoses. These are the things which I have to look for.
Yeah.
Okay. From the X-ray, ECG, all those things, we got some idea. These things are very unlikely. Okay. So that is very important. Venous drainage, it is extremely important. You have to look for SVC drainage, IVC drainage, the pulmonary venous drainage, and coronary sinus. Left SVC, is it is there or not? So these are the things which usually we miss. All the other things we look for, we discussed also. But venous drainage, you have to look for. Going back a little clinical, how will you suspect a TAPVC? TAPVC is suspected in an infant who comes. Usually they present with acute pulmonary edema. Now there will be some levels of obstruction. I'll take 1 or 2 minutes because TAPVC, what are the levels of obstruction? Obstructed TAPVC. Can you tell me?
Sir, Lungi, yes, sir. Usually, sir, in TAPVC, there is supracardiac or intracardiac. In supracardiac, the obstruction can be hemodynamic wise, where it can be obstructed because of that is between left pulmonary artery and the bronchus. Other thing in the infracardiac is usually obstructed. There where it usually obstructs at the level of its entry into the either portal vein or into the hepatic vein or into the IVC.
I think sir's video or audio is not audible. So
can we go on to the CAT?
Can you go to the CAT?
Sir, actually, we don't have CAT data on this patient.
Okay, you have not done until now?
This is our answer.
Okay, and did you check the saturation?
Yes, the saturation was 75 to 80% at room air rest.
Okay, you examined how many times?
Sir, two times I examined.
There is some problem with the...
So how now much was there?
Okay. Sir, it was between 75 to 80%. In both the terms that it was ranging from that. It was below 80.
In examination, you say one value. Don't say 75 to 80 because you are supposed to examine the case once. So, do you have got any investigation report? Like how much is his hemoglobin?
Sir, based on that is formula, that is 36 minus saturation divided by 4, we can get the expected hemoglobin in this patient.
36 minus?
Saturation divided by 4.
So how much you got in this patient? Okay. So last question on echo. How you see override of aorta?
Sir, in overriding of aorta, we can see in plex view and in the apical pore chamber view. That is... how much of the aortic aorta is on the left or right of the interventricular septum.
Any other? Suppose it is not very properly seen, then what do you take help of? Sometimes suppose it's not properly visible, aorta is very much dilated. So how you take help of anything else?
Color flow, we can get from color flows.
Okay. Mohit?
Yeah.
Oh,
Dr. Sudhay has having a problem in the joining. He just called.
I can hear the discussion. Can you hear me?
Yeah, sir. Please,
I can see you. No problem. Go ahead because we need not waste time. Go ahead, please.
Okay. So, how you plan to manage this patient quickly?
Sorry, do you have the hemodynamic data?
No, no sir. They are not yet to care.
Okay, okay, not needed.
Mm. So we can we can sir medic initially that a patient requires a surgical management, that is intracardiac repair. But if the patient gets to intracardiac repair, we can optimize the medical management with the beta blockers.
Anything else?
Other thing, the things which should patient be avoided, like dehydration, that is a measurement of hemoglobin and supplementation of oxygen, supplementation of iron, and management of the cyanotic spell. And if there is the anatomy is not favorable at present, then the initial shunt is done. But patient is having a good anatomy and the age is also 12 years. So
he is 12 years. This is the anatomy exactly nicely seen. So can we send him to surgery without doing a CAT? Or otherwise, if I ask you,
no, we
at all needed. What is the requirement of a CAT in this patient?
Sir, to look for the major aortopulmonary collaterals and to look for the coronary artery
collateral.
Yes, sir. And coronary artery anatomy.
Okay.
So, and any there is multiple BSD peripher to recommend.
BSD mostly you have already excluded because your echo window is very good. So, out of the two, which one will prefer, CAT or CT angio?
CT angio, sir. CT angio.
So, can you see collaterals through CT angio? Significant collaterals?
No, sir. Significant collaterals cannot be seen with the CT angio. It requires.
So then why you choose CT angio?
Sir, because sir, in this patient, we are not expecting major autopulmonary collateral. So initially, to look for the pulmonary anatomy, CT pulmonary angiotensin, and as case study can have some time.
I don't agree with your point because your murmur is very brief, you said, and he is 12 years surviving with a brief murmur. So he has to have some flow, and LV is good. So where from the flow has come to LV? So there are plus and minus. If you go by other argument, yes. But if you go by these arguments that LV is well formed, then LVRV nearly equal, then you get a very brief murmur. He's surviving up to 12 years without having any significant syncope as this one at present. So that indicates there may be collaterals. So which one you will prefer?
Sir, after the revision, I will prefer angiography, conventional
catheterization.
Yes.
Any other reason? Again, catheterization. Any other reason? Then one is the collateral that I said, and you said that you. But any other reason?
Additional things can you see on cath?
Yes, sir. Additional thing that we can see that is patient is having the if there is a obstruction at multiple level, we can grade with the help of pressure data, or we can see the coronary anomalies better with case study.
No, you are totally wrong. Coronary anomalies are best seen in CT, very rare, sometimes miss with CAT. So that is wrong. CT is best for coronary anomaly than CAT any day. But your point is that, as Mohit has tried to prompt you, is that pressures are seen in CAT by mistake. Even if you miss something in CT angio, that is most important, is pressure is always missed. So pressures will be picked up nicely in a CAT. Even sometimes in adult tetralogy, like 12 years, we can go to PA easily. We can check PA if we find something discrepant. So we can easily go. The most important point, answer number one should be that if there is significant collateral, we can coil also at the same time.
Yes.
We can coil also at the same time so that he need not to come to CAT lab for another setting to embolize big collaterals, which may be precluding his surgery. So, yes. 3 points. One is pressures. If any discrepancy, pressure can be checked. Second is collaterals is better picked up here. Coronaries are better picked up by CT angio. And third is if a collaterals need to be coiled, it can be done at the same time so that he need not to come to for CAT second time. So, what is the most important thing that need to be looked in echo or CAT for long-term survival of these tough patients? What is the most single, most important parameter is that is looked for long-term survival diastolic repair?
Left ventricle end-diastolic volume, sir. Because after the intracardiac repair, LV will be systemic. So
pre-op, you should say, so from ECHO, you should have been said whether LV is adequate or not, that you say from LV inflow versus RV inflow ratio. So if it is more than two-thirds, then you say it is adequate. But these are the points that Sumudh must have told you. But I am saying that pulmonary annulus is the most important thing. Mm-hmm. So your answer should have been pulmonary annulus. If it is hypoplastic annulus, then you will go for annuloplasty, then it will lead to PR, that will lead to failure of the
artery.
So most important point to look is how is the pulmonary annulus in comparison to aortic annulus, okay?
Yes, very important.
Sir,
yes,
you are audible and you can give some concluding remarks. Sir. Yeah.
Right.
Yes, sir.
He's having a very poor network. We can go ahead.
You can go ahead. You can go ahead. I can't see you people, but I can hear you.
Okay. So, concluding, sir. Also, before sending the surgery, two most important thing is the pulmonary annulus, then level of obstruction and coronary anomalies, so that surgery is not hampered. These are the points that we see before sending. Of course, LV adequacy is one of the most important. As you said, LV end-diastolic volume will be one of the factors for long-term survival. But that can be assessed even pre-op also. So, I think, Sumud, anything more to be discussed?
Yeah, I think we had a very good discussion. I don't think that.
So,
Danji, you have done well.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
I think the student has done extremely well. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, very well. Very well, sir.
The student has done extremely well. But only thing is, he has to, only suggestion is listen to the question and try to be very brief and to the point. You start with the explanation and then coming to the answer. Better will be if the answer is straightforward, put the answer. And then if you're asked, go for the explanation, that you will fetch more marks. Definitely, you have done extremely well. And this case is an ideal case for a surgical management because the anatomy is so good. The RVOT is good. The pulmonary arteries are very good. The pulmonary vasculature and the pulmonary blood flow is not that bad. From the X-ray as well as from the echocardiogram, the anatomy is very good. As mentioned earlier, the surgical this in coronary artery anatomy. Nowadays, people are not very keen in a straightforward tetralogy or phallo to have the coronary angiogram or all those things. Echo, you should show only the origin of the coronary arteries, because when they are opening, they can see whether the coronary artery, anything is crossing, the coronary artery is crossing the RVOT, they can look into. And nowadays, many people avoid transventricular approach. Some people go with the pulmonary arterial approach also. Anyway, it was a good session. It is extremely happy and nice. Really enjoyed the session with all my colleagues. Thanks, Dr. Mohit and et al. All the people for giving me the chance to share our experience with our dear students. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Ranjit. Thank you, Dr. Sudha Kumar, for exceptional teaching. It was a great learning, mutual learning, and especially the approach, which is more important rather than, you know, just presenting the case and reading the theory. So every single comment that you are making has to be very well justifiable right from the history, as Dr. Sudhay and Dr. Ranjit clearly highlighted. So it was a great mutual learning, I believe. And the clinical application, the practical application of knowledge is what is very important, because we keep on reading theory, which is just piling up of facts, and wisdom is simplifying it. So you are actually implying and using all these tricks of the trade here when you are presenting a case. And thank you, Dr. Sumudh and Girish, for joining us. And sir, we have more than 400 residents and they are writing to us continuously. It is obviously an exceptional session. We'll be coming up next week with another case. and with the other set of experts so that we can have another very beautiful discussion. Thank you for joining us today evening. Thank you, Intas, for providing us this platform.
Dr. Mohit, next session also send me that your communication so that I also be interested in listening, not actively participating.
No, sir. There's no scope of listening.
I'll put it like this. Now, the session should be given to 2 or 3 examiners for the main. I would like to learn from others. So I will be a part of the audience. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much.
Thank you,
Ranjit. Bye.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thanks. Class.